If you're like me, you can chart your development as a cook over the years by the pizzas you've pulled from your oven. So my early pizza was an English muffin, split in half, topped with jarred pizza sauce and string cheese that I tore into pieces. That would go into the toaster oven until the cheese drooled from the sides and ignited on the coils below. So the middle years are best described as homemade-ish. Go to the supermarket, I'd get a frozen pizza, and then patch that really sparse coating of freezer-burned cheese with some pre-grated fresh mozzarella. From there, I graduated to going to the supermarket or an accommodating local pizza shop for pre-made dough. Don't get me wrong, all of these pizzas were delicious. They were pizza after all. But it wasn't until I understood that good pizza is all about good dough that my pies really started to shine. So let's talk about some dough science. If you mix together flour, water, yeast, salt, and a little bit of olive oil, let it rise on the counter for about an hour and bake it off, it tastes like, well, it doesn't taste like very much. Worse still, if you try to stretch that into a nice round pizza, it's a nightmare. The key to a dough that is flavorful and easy to stretch isn't years of baking experience. It isn't special water and it isn't some fancy technique. It's time. Going slow is really good for pizza for two big reasons. The first is flavor. When a dough ferments, enzymes that are naturally present in the flour break down starches into sugars. Those sugars are then fermented by the yeast into flavorful acids, alcohols, and carbon dioxide. That carbon dioxide expands bubbles that are already present in the dough from the mixing process. At room temperature, the process moves rapidly. But once it goes into the fridge, everything slows way down. Check out this dough that was fermented quickly on the counter, and compare that to this dough that was fermented slowly in the fridge for 2 days. That's a big difference. With enough time, those complex tasting acids and alcohols can build to significant enough levels to make a dough with big flavor. Next up is texture. So good pizza dough starts with a high protein flour like bread flour. And when we need a dough that's made with bread flour, we develop lots of gluten, which is a really special protein that forms a flexible network. Gluten is the reason that a dough can hold onto that carbon dioxide in the first place. And it's also responsible for that satisfying chew we love in pizza. So we love gluten in pizza, we need gluten in pizza, but gluten is also the thing that makes a pizza dough hard to stretch. A long rest in the fridge allows some of those tight bonds that holds the gluten network together to unclench. And at the same time, protease enzymes, which are naturally present in the dough, are able to snip some of the gluten and make it more extensible or easier to stretch. Here's the best way to see this transformation. So I made two identical pizza doughs and I washed them under cold water until all the starch was gone. So I'm left with basically two balls of mostly gluten. I let one sit on the counter for about an hour, and the other one sat in the fridge for 3 days. Notice, look at how differently the gluten behaves. So the fresh ball of gluten is a springy, bouncy mess. On the other hand, the 3-day-old gluten stretches evenly and beautifully. That's the power of time. Okay, it's time to make some pizza. Let's go to the kitchen. So I'm gonna start by placing a baking steel in the middle rack of this oven. You can also use a baking stone, but if you're doing that, you wanna be on the highest rack. And I'm gonna preheat my oven to 500 degrees. So while that preheats for at least an hour, I'm gonna get my dough out of the fridge, and I'm gonna let that sit at room temperature for a full hour. Now, the warmer that dough is, the easier it will be to stretch. So I'm gonna coat the entire ball of dough in flour. It's gonna make it really easy to stretch, and then simply stretch it to a 12-inch circle. And you can see that is an absolute breeze. So I'm gonna transfer it over to the peel now, and I'm using this really cool canvas line peel. So now I'm gonna top my pizza. I'm gonna use some tomato sauce, not the jarred stuff this time, and some mozzarella. I also love pepperoni, so we're gonna go a bunch of pepperoni on top. Now, right before I put this in the oven, I'm also gonna switch from bake to broil. And that's really important if you're using a steel, because that steel transfers heat really, really rapidly. So we need something on top that's gonna transfer heat just as fast. If you're using a stone, don't bother switching it over. Just bake at 500 degrees. Okay, so now I'm gonna transfer it in. We're gonna bake until that cheese is bubbly, it's charred on top, and it's really crispy on the bottom. Ugh, look at that awesome melty cheese. So now we just transfer it over to a cutting board, slice it up, and I tend to eat it right away and really just burn my mouth. This is how to eat pizza.